Barry Lynn joins us. The Reverend Barry Lynn was the executive director of Americans United for Separation of Church and State from 1992 to November of 2017. He is an ordained minister in the United Church of, I think I'm pronouncing this correctly, Christ. Did I get that right?
Yes, you certainly did.
Thank
you. It's admirable because it's so confusing at this time of year.
It sure is. It most certainly is. You are a reverend and a lawyer and an author. Many of your books are available over at Amazon. You might want to pick up Piety and Politics, The Right-Wing Assault on Religious Freedom.
Or.
Yeah.
Or God and Government.
Piety and Politics.
Well, you could pick up both of them. Yeah. That's probably a way to buy both of them in the same order and avoid paying some tiny fraction of taxes or shipping.
Isn't it pronounced piety?
No, it's piety.
Now I'm confused. I really am. I thought I was making a joke.
No, I've told you this three times. We went to the Merriam-Webster dictionary people, and because you constantly mispronounce what is, in fact, piety as piety, I asked them to change it, and so they did change it.
Oh,
so now
okay.
It's piety.
Okay. It's pronounced piety. Oh, so I get what you're trying to do.
Yeah. Try and just.
So now I'm going to say piety.
Confuse you.
Yeah. Okay.
Yeah.
Well, Reverend, where are you? Where did we get you today?
I'm on the South Shore, south of Boston, about 25 miles in Hanover, Massachusetts, right now.
How was your Christmas?
My Christmas was terrific. The only potential drawback, I do have, as I've mentioned a couple times, possibly 100 times, two 2-year-old granddaughters, both of whom have been sick most of the last week, and they had some of their small friends over for the last few hours, and they were all sick too. So now I'm sick.
Well, I'm sick as well.
Were you here? Were you hiding somewhere?
No,
in their house?
No, but I am down for the count. Luckily, you can do this show sick. It's actually better when you're sick.
That's great. Then it should be twice as good because we're both.
Yes. America.
That was good. That's the kind of sound that you make when you call your employer to explain on a Monday when you've really been up late watching football that you're sick. And you go, hey, I'm really
That's good. So let me ask you what the symptoms are. Do you have, I guess you have a cough, right? A cough. Is it a wet cough?
No, it's a dry cough because this is a very dry house in which I'm living. I'm trying to put humidity into the air. I'm obsessed with the idea that you should sleep as a human being pretty much in a greenhouse. So the humidity is incredibly high because then you don't get a cough. Then you don't choke. Your eyes don't become irritable. You don't sneeze. You just, if anything, you just feel like you're drowning when you wake up in the middle of the night.
I always feel like I'm drowning when I wake up in the middle of the night. That's because I'm incontinent, but that's a whole other story.
That's another story. When you wake up, don't call me.
I won't. I'll get electrocuted. my bed isn't grounded. So do you have a sore throat?
Yeah, of course. Of course I do. Don't you?
Yes. Do you have a stuffed nose?
Yes, I do have that too.
And are you logy and kind of blue?
Oh, absolutely.
Because you don't feel well.
Exactly. But it's a good season. I mean, I want to feel good, and I do feel good about when I take enough medications and am in a room with a humidifier, then I do feel pretty good, and I like it, and I think we should, that's what I'm searching for the new year.
Right.
I want to celebrate the new year cold-free, sniffle-free, cough-free, and runny nose-free.
Okay. Now, you're a reverend,
Yes, I am.
You're an ordained minister.
Yes, I am.
Let's talk about Christmas, the important stuff. What did you get?
I got some woolly kind of socks that are kind of slippers from someone's mother. But, you know, I didn't get anything, like, from my wife. I didn't get anything from her at all. I don't want anything. I don't need more stuff. I'm trying to get rid of stuff. I don't want more stuff. And so when people were criticizing the president for saying, admitting that he had only gotten a card for Melania, but as of some period late into Christmas Eve, he still hadn't bought her a present, and people were going, and they were insulting him. Mm-hmm. And I thought, he's just like me, because I'll bet I won't be getting a present either. I had gotten my wife a present, though. Do you want to know what I got her?
Is it clean? I mean, can we talk about
it? Yes, it is.
Okay.
Yes, it is. I got her a book about environmental law. I got her a little kind of fake gold necklace. I got it on deep discount at the Target store for $15. And I got her some ginger chews, which have some kind of quasi-medical benefit for her.
Okay. Now, I'm not violating your privacy by saying that you married way above your your weight, your class.
No, I certainly agree with that.
Yeah.
And perhaps she would agree with it, too. But I'll tell you what really proved this to me is we have a niece who's a professional photographer, and she was recovering some of my late mother-in-law's old black and white negatives, and she was printing them out about 6 months ago. And at a family get together, she said, "These are some pictures I found of you and Joanne when you first got married." And I was a genuinely bizarre looking person at that time. Now, what does that mean?
Did she say that, or did you?
No, I said that. I looked at myself and I said, "My God, who could dress like that and have the hairstyle that I had?"
You mean the collar? You're talking about the minister collar and the black shirt?
No, I'm talking
about
those
are perennials. That's like seersucker, Reverend. That never goes out of style. What are you talking about?
Seersucker never does. I did own a seersucker suit once. I think I did wear it once or twice, but I came a long way, because by 1970, I was being referred to as telegenic by no less an authority on appearance than Penthouse magazine. And they said, "He is a telegenic man defending people's right to read." See?
Yeah. Well, is that because your wife dressed you?
She kept saying, "Go to the store when they have those four suits for $100 and get four." Yeah, four.
Okay.
Yeah, because I didn't think you had to pay more than $25 for a suit. Why would you do that? Mm-hmm. That's what I thought. But then when she decided maybe I ought to go a little higher, then I went, I shopped at Labor Day, Memorial Day, at some of these chain stores that are around. I don't want to give them any free publicity, but you could buy three suits. Mm-hmm. You get to pay the first 100% of the first one, although it was deeply discounted. Then you get the second one for 50% off, and then the third for 75% off. And that's the kind of shopper that I was. And I don't shop anymore because, as I just told you, I don't want to get any more stuff. I don't want any more suits. I don't want any more ties. I don't want any more shirts. I don't want any more shoes. I just want to be left alone with the possessions I have and the music that I still buy.
Well, if you vote for Bernie, we will come and take everything.
Yeah. Could you take it before you even get elected?
Yeah.
Hey, in the Bernie administration, let me be serious about it. What do you expect to be in Bernie's administration? Do you expect, for example, to be on the communications staff or in the White House, perhaps a spokesperson for President Sanders.
I will probably be criticizing him the day after he's sworn in.
Well,
he will be a disappointment. He will be the greatest disappointment of my life. I love Bernie. They would never.
Yeah, I know you do.
Yeah, I love him. But the minute he becomes president, I hate him.
Yeah.
That's you know, job.
Why don't you give him a week?
No.
Well, he's going to criticize him on the very first day. Yeah. I'm sorry to hear that. I would give him at least a week, maybe even a month.
Well, let me ask you about candidates who say we need to, you know, calm the nation down and dial back the rancor. What if this is just the way it's always going to be from now on?
It's the way it always was.
Yeah. So get over that. Like, you know, if you want to be president, you want to run for office, wear a cup. And, you know, it's going to get bad, you know.
Sure. I mean, you know, if you read books, and there's several good books written about the press during the immediate post-colonial period. I mean, newspapers would print anything. They would print, you know, they came out with one or two editions a day in a place like Philadelphia. And in the morning edition, they might say that somebody named the guy and accused him of being a thief. And then people would show up at his house and try to burn his house down. And then even if it wasn't true, that it didn't matter because the damage was either done or not done. Maybe the guy was able to come out and say, wait a minute, I didn't do this. I have proof. Somebody else did it. But the rancor of those early post-colonial newspapers in many of the colonies was unmatched. I mean, it was matched by what we see today. But when people say, oh, we shouldn't go negative, if you're running for office, why the hell wouldn't you go negative about the people you're running against? That's the whole point of being elected. People don't go, oh, well, he's not that bad. You want to say he's really terrible. That's why I want to be in the shoes of him or her because I'm better. And that's what we ought to say. And that's what we ought to run on. And I've always said that. And if you ever run for office, and then I'm going to run against you and say all the things that, you know, I want to say on this program every week, but I'm afraid to.
Well, we know you're thinking them.
Yeah, no, I am. In fact, I scratch out little notes and little pictures, and you ought to see what I'm drawing right now.
By the way, this whole show, let me see if, can you hear me coughing? Hang on.
Of course I can.
All right, how about now? Did you hear that one?
Of course I can. Well, how are you going to convince me and the listeners that you are sick if I can't even hear you cough?
All right, but hang on. I'm going to hit the cough button.
Okay.
And you tell me if you can hear it. All right, one, two, three. did you hear that?
Of course I can hear it.
You heard that?
Of course I can hear it.
All right, let me try this.
Most of these cough buttons don't even work.
Oh, you know what? This is the cough button that makes me cough. Okay, let me try this one.
Yeah.
Hang on.
Okay.
Did you hear that?
No.
You didn't hear that?
No, I didn't hear it.
Hang on. No, you didn't hear that?
No, I didn't hear it. Nope.
Oh, okay. And now I know which button to hit.
That's great. I'm glad I can help. So I managed to get you to pronounce the word Christ correctly, and I've gotten you to find the correct cough button. That's a twofer. Before this segment is over, I'm hoping we do a third so that I can get a trifecta of corrections to David Feldman.
Maybe I'll pronounce piety properly. So Christmas. There's no mention of Christmas in the New Testament.
Of course there's not. In fact, the early Christians who came to the United States in general opposed, they didn't just not celebrate, they opposed using this as a celebratory moment. They may have gone to church, But they didn't put up trees, and they didn't put up lights, and they didn't go to the shopping malls that didn't even exist, and they didn't have stuff to return the day after Christmas. They just had a certain spiritual connection to this holiday, but they affirmatively did not believe in celebrating Christmas.
And do we know whether or not Jesus was born on December, 25th?
Yeah, no, we're almost certain he wasn't. He was probably born in the spring, but this became a time of celebration, and it was defined as the 25th of December centuries ago, and probably centuries after any historical Jesus died. So no, this was not a winter event. There was no snow in the manger. The three wise men did not have to ride on camels through the snow. None of that would have happened.
Okay.
It's an interesting myth. I like the Santa Claus myth too, but I don't really think he delivered 17 billion presents just two nights ago, flying in a sled with magic reindeer. But I do listen for them every Christmas Eve, and sometimes I'm convinced I actually hear them. Do you ever hear them?
I've got, you know, noise on my roof Christmas night.
You think it's reindeer?
I think it could be reindeer. More likely roof rats.
Yep, could be roof rats.
And
I must say that there is something that I now agree with about President Trump. He gave this long rambling speech a few days ago to a group of conservative young people, and he explained that he was against windmills. He said he had studied them extensively, that we don't make many in the United States. And he also said that they're a danger to birds. And he said that if you go to a windmill and look underneath it, it looks like a bird cemetery. And I've always been skeptical of wind power for a couple of reasons. One is they're very noisy. Anybody that's gone to that big wind farm at the southernmost tip of the United States, which is in the southernmost island in Hawaii, it's noisy. It makes a hell of a racket. It's very annoying, and it scars the landscape. But there happens to be one just about 2 miles from where I'm speaking to you now.
Oh, this is the one today. Ted Kennedy wanted to block.
This was not one that he wanted to block, but yes, it's the same idea. They're an annoying environmental fixture. But so I went to see whether it was a bird cemetery, and I drove into the parking lot where there's a building underneath a windmill. And I looked at the ground, and it's been snowing up here. So there, it was a lot of wet stuff on the ground. And what appeared, frankly, to be a dead rodent. I didn't see any birds, but I did see a dead rodent. So maybe it was killed by the windmills. Maybe it had climbed up in the windmill. Or maybe it was just because it was right next to a mall that was showing 8 movies, one of which was Cats.
Ah.
See? Could have been that.
Could have been. So, funerals for pets. Would Jesus approve of people burying their dogs with a tombstone or their cat and having a tombstone? What would Jesus say about that?
Yeah, I have a feeling he'd be okay with that, frankly, because it's the spirit of being connected to this other species so much that you really care about its death. And when it dies, and you want to bury it in some way, honor it in some way, I think he'd be fine with that. I think he would not be fine with building a very large mausoleum to a cat, or even to a dog, but certainly not to a cat.
Can a cat or a dog have a religion?
Do you ever see the play Cats?
I walked out of it.
Yeah, I desperately wanted to, but I didn't have the courage of my conviction to walk out. But then what? Some of those cats did ritualistic things, so maybe they were practicing a religion. But there's no cats were occasionally viewed as sacred animals in certain Egyptian traditions, but as far as I know, there's not an organized religion for dogs or for cats, but it's another good racket to think about. And in fact, to get back to the Church of Feldman,
yes, yeah, go on.
But you should have a kind of auxiliary, a pet auxiliary. A cat. Cats are better than dogs. So many people like cats. They have an enormous number of them. I'm highly allergic to them, so I'm never going to come. You never invited me to any service at the Church of Feldman, even though I'm, you know, I do this chaplaincy thing for you every week. But yeah, set it up and then start to collect money, and it will just be one more stream of revenue, as we call it in the church business, stream of revenue for the Church of Feldman.
Now, the Church of Feldman, can we buy up medical debt? I hear that's a big thing now with churches.
No, it's a very interesting phenomenon. There is an organization. It's called RIP, as in rest in peace, RIP Medical Debt. It's a nonprofit that uses donations that are given to it to buy bundles of medical debt and then erase that debt. And you and I have talked about medical debt. It's crushing. If you can buy $50,000 worth of medical debt of other people for about $500. And there's actually a church, the Christian Assembly Church out in Eagle Rock, California, that a few nights ago at a service, they announced that they've been given $53,000 from parishioners to erase $5.3 million,
wow,
in debt. Now that sounds good, and it is good, but you have to know what you're doing. And ironically, I happen to be having dinner just tonight with somebody who works in this field, and he said it's an interesting idea, but you have to do it very carefully, because in some states, if you forgive someone else's debt, that becomes a taxable event for them, and they could end up having to be taxed for it. They're also, you have to be careful whose debt you're buying, because in some states, there are hospitals that, although they keep sending you bills, never, ever bother to try to enforce that debt. So you got to know what you're doing.
Well, hang on for one second.
So, clever idea.
Yeah, well, let's go over this for a second, because I find this interesting. It might be a good income stream for the Church of Feldman.
Possibly.
So people get sick, they borrow money in America to pay, sure, their medical bills. That's debt.
Yep.
When you don't pay that, it gets passed off to, it's purchased by, usually a collection agency buys that debt from the hospital, right? So if you owe,
that's right,
if you owe the hospital $100,000, they realize they can't collect it, so they'll sell it to a collection agency for, say, what, $25,000?
Yeah, I mean, is often 10% of the face value of it. And then the collection agency has a couple of options, as I understand this, a couple of options to try to collect it. They might negotiate with a person in debt to pay a fraction of the debt. They might make a deal with the person or with the hospital they're buying it from to get a certain amount for every one of these debt collections that is successful, or at least successful at a certain level. But it's a very big business.
Another reason we're not going to get Medicare for All. Just another tentacle,
yeah,
that profits off
it
people
is
being sick.
No, it absolutely is. But, you know, these are, yeah, I mean, what are you going to do? This is part of the system. But as I said, the truth of this is that there are a lot of medical related debts that are never in fact, collected. You can keep getting the letters for years. You owe this plus interest, but nobody's ever going to come to your house and try to collect it. So before you start buying off somebody else's medical debt to be a generous and good person, you have to be sure that it was going to be enforceable debt in the first place.
Okay,
and that's complicated.
For the Church of Feldman.
Yeah, how are you going to work it?
What if we buy the debt? You say we can buy like $100,000 worth of debt for $500?
Yeah, no, I think I said for $1,000, but let's not quibble. Yeah, you can get it for next to nothing.
But what? Wait, you can buy $100,000 of debt for how much?
$1,000.
Okay, and I say to my listeners, help us buy medical debt.
Yes.
Donate.
Yep.
And we will buy this medical debt.
That's right.
And then we will try to collect that medical debt from the people who owe it.
Yeah. And you could do that.
Right. And
but
we
then
would
you
say,
would be profiting off of their misery, the well, very we, thing
no, no, no,
that
no.
you
no,
and I
no.
don't agree.
No, we're telling them this is, you know, you didn't pay this because you owed it to the hospital and the hospital is evil. Now sure. This debt is owned by the Church of Feldman.
That's right.
You have a moral responsibility to pay the Church of Feldman.
Exactly.
And so we tell the people who are giving the money that we're going to forgive their debt.
That's right.
And maybe we forgive some of it. We're not lying. We said we'd forgive their debt. We didn't say we were going to forgive all of their debt.
Yeah.
I got a sense you're not willing to work with me on this.
Let me finish this picture I've been drawing for the last 20. No, I think that would be a bad idea. I mean, it's a clever idea, but I think it would ultimately be a bad and immoral and a downright evil idea. But hey, look, there are a lot of things that happen in America's religious groups. Groups all over the world. A guy I used to debate a lot, Alan Keyes, who was the Ronald Reagan's ambassador to the United Nations, I notice is now getting in hot water because he is selling some kind of a bleach product.
Right, you talked about this last week.
Cure everything.
Yeah.
Well, that's a racket. I can hook you up with him if you have no sense of morality or decency,
yeah.
Which you're kind of demonstrating about the medical debt. I'm sure you and Alan would get along fine.
I'm just saying we buy the medical debt and we have the listeners chip in.
Yeah.
And we promise that we're going to forgive the medical debt.
Yeah.
We just don't tell them that we're not forgiving all of it.
It's good. We could write that, the disclaimer.
Okay.
You know, perhaps you give to charities, right?
What's the point of you setting up the Church of Feldman if I don't live better? If I don't end up, I don't get two jets out of this?
I want to help you set it up so you can live better, so that you don't have rats on your roof making noises. I want that to happen to you because I care about you. I like you. I think you're a very smart and very funny person. So I want to do good things for you, but kind of like your debt buying scheme, it doesn't mean I want to give you everything, and it doesn't mean that I want to help you become a multimillionaire. Did you see on ABC the other night that long 2-hour piece about Tammy Faye and Jim Baker?
She passed away. He's still around.
She did.
He's selling bunker food.
Yes, he's selling bunker food. And he's selling it in the same way that, do you know that he was in prison for a while and he was originally sentenced to 45 years in prison. Then he got a lawyer, perhaps you've heard of him, Alan Dershowitz.
Great man.
Who managed to reduce that time to, I think, 2.5 years.
Which is usually the age of his girlfriends.
I wouldn't comment on that.
Yeah.
I was doing a deep dive into YouTube, and I came across a recording that I think, although I didn't watch much of it, but I think it was 2 hours long, of a debate in which Alan and myself and a couple of other people were on with Bill Buckley debating some topic. But I just hope that doesn't leak out in the event that I run for president in 4 years.
I'd like to see that. I'd like to see that.
Okay, go to you. I don't know where it is. I don't know what it. Just go put in Alan Dershowitz, Bill Buckley, Barry Lynn, and I bet you're going to find it.
Okay, talk to me about the big Christianity Today fizzle.
Yeah, that was a big fizzle. We talked about it last week, and I said that Christianity Today is not nearly as significant a publication as it was in the when it was founded by Billy Graham and through the 60s. I was interested, though, to see that the circulation numbers of Christianity Today, after they published an editorial just last week suggesting that it was time for Donald Trump not only to be impeached, but to be removed from office. And it created an enormous amount of blowback from right-wing Christian groups. But it did gain them more circulation. But now that we're through this by about a week, it's clear that some of the people who thought they were subscribing to some liberal, progressive Christian magazine find out that this magazine is still bitterly homophobic, anti-choice in regard to abortion and birth control, and they're not going to like what they see. And also, mainstream religious people, I just saw a blog about this today, said if it takes this magazine this long and a claim of defilement of national security to call for someone to be removed from office, that means that person, that publication's been able to avoid saying anything about children in cages, cutbacks to health services, to food, groping women, that all of that stuff apparently wasn't enough. But when you say, well, you could destabilize Ukraine, that's a national security issue, he should be impeached and thrown out of office, that's a being a little bit of a good Christian, well too late. And I got to say, they're right. And as I said, I think last week, there are these weird things in that editorial. Some of the things that the president has done are fine. What's fine? There's nothing he has done that's fine. Short of sending out perhaps you didn't get a greeting card from him. But here's what it was. It says, at Christmas, we remember this eternal truth. Every person is a beloved child of God. I guess that's why we took, 200 kids away from their parents on Christmas Eve, caged them, and then told them to take care of each other. That's why we recently found that we're going to be cutting food assistance for 700,000 people. I guess that's what it means to be a beloved child of God in the church of Donald Trump.
They really took 200 kids on Christmas Eve?
Yeah, there are well-documented photos of a group of kids, some like 2 years old. They wouldn't let them close to their parents or relatives, and they had them basically in a cage. And they were basically being told, look, we don't have enough people to take care of you. Take care of yourself. You got a kid brother? Take care of them. Kids were sick. And, of course, we know from the past experiences that children have literally died under those conditions, sometimes while being monitored by officials at the border. I mean, it's just beyond human conception that this could be tolerated.
You're right. It is. Amen. It is. Amen.
Yeah. Amen, I'll say that.
No joke. I'm not going to make a joke. It's disgusting. It really is.
55%. Latest poll I saw today, 55% of Americans now want him removed from office. 40% don't. And the other 15% aren't sure yet. Aren't sure.
Yeah. Well, what does Mayor Pete get right about religion?
Well, Mayor Pete today sent out a little tweet in which he said, he's not doing terribly well with African-American voters, but this could change because literally a couple hours ago he tweeted out, extending warm wishes to all those celebrating the start of Kwanzaa. See, this is how connected he is to the African-American community. But here's how disconnected he is from the Christian community. He did send out a thing the day before Christmas, a tweet in which he was appreciative of, wanted to honor everybody's celebration of Christmas. But in a very calculated way, he never mentioned Jesus. So he didn't mention the birth of Jesus. He just made some reference to this is a season in which the divine came to earth. That sounds a little new agey to a lot of people who just wanted to know, it's about Jesus. That's the reason for the season, as the bumper sticker says. But Mayor Pete just apparently couldn't get to that level of commitment. So he managed to screw that up. I don't know if this wishing people a happy start to Kwanzaa is going to go over. If it does, I mean, he's already missed Solstice, which is, of course, a big pagan and Wiccan holiday. And I don't think he tweeted about that. So, I have always hated the very fact that people have outreach forces or outreach organizations or parts of their organizations based on religion. You shouldn't have Jewish outreach, Muslim outreach, Presbyterian outreach. If it's a moral issue and it's a moral message, then focus people on the moral question, not on what religion they're ostensibly affiliated with. I've always hated that. I hated that back in the day when Al Gore had a religious outreach person. And she was quoted in the New York Times about how this was going to be a major factor in the campaign. And it's a very bad idea. I don't think that Jimmy Carter, who is without a doubt still the most conventionally religious person who's ever served in the presidency in modern history, possibly ever, he's still out building Habitat for Humanity buildings. But he didn't have a religious outreach program. He didn't have a White House Office of Faith-Based Initiatives like both George Bush and Barack Obama had. He just did it. By their fruits, you shall know them. That, of course, is something I quoted to you just a week or two ago from the letter to James. One of the things that drives the religious right craziest is because it says in that book, very short book, you could read it like between coughs, by their fruits you shall know them. Yeah.
How long does it take to?
Well, he actually said I misquoted that. It's what the book of James says is faith without works is dead. Faith without work is dead.
Now, James was Jesus's brother?
Probably the letter was written to him, but it's very unclear. There's a lot of dispute about exactly who most of the recipients of those letters were.
But Jesus had a brother named Jimmy.
James, yep.
Jimmy, they called him Jimmy.
Yeah, they called him they called him Jimbo once, and he was very irritated by that. And
was he the younger or older brother?
No, I think he was an older brother.
That must suck.
It was probably terrible. Hey, you were probably pretty happy today, though, weren't you?
I'm never happy.
I meant relatively speaking, because of a religious phenomenon. Perhaps you do you know Rabbi Arnold Reznikoff by any chance? Rabbi Arnold Reznikoff. No.
I have a Reznikoff, but I've learned how to use the button.
Well, you know, they're having these pro forma sessions of the House of Representatives just in case anybody needs to get any urgent business done. And they actually had one today, and Rabbi Resnikoff gave the opening prayer. And it got a little attention because it's actually a pretty affirming prayer. But what got more attention was the fact that he was wearing a tie with a dreidel on it.
Ah.
What is a dreidel?
A dreidel is a betting game that kids play during Hanukkah. It's this little thing that you spin and you bet on, will it land on, like, Aleph or whatever the Hebrew.
Baltic Avenue?
Yeah, kind of like that. And you bet with.
Yeah. So he wore a tie with images of dreidels on it, and it got a lot of. I was sent many links to C-SPAN's very brief House session this morning, and 2 minutes of it was Rabbi Resnikoff in his dreidel tie giving a very thoughtful prayer. But I just thought perhaps because you obviously don't. You don't worry about having chaplains paid for by the taxpayers or this event of having local religious leaders pray for free for 2 minutes every day. I thought you might know Rabbi Resnikoff.
Well, I don't approve of dreidels. So.
No, I don't think you should. I think you should be opposed to dreidels. And,
what's going on there?
That was a phone call coming in. Let me see who the hello. Yeah, and this guy's. I don't think you could hear that, but he said that because of my fine payment history, he had some credit card information that he wanted to pass on to me so that I could lower my credit card rate.
Ah, did you tell him you don't buy stuff?
Yeah, but I pay for it.
Okay.
See, I pay.
Before you go,
yeah,
let's talk about Richard Jewell.
I'd love to.
That's the Clint Eastwood movie, right?
Yeah, I would love to do, and I am going to do that. But I just feel compelled to talk about how the Democrats could still screw up impeachment. Do we have a few minutes for
sure?
Okay. One of the things I believe I talked about this on this show last week. This is an idea that now has been taken up. I don't think he heard it from me, but who knows? Maybe he listens to your show. Larry Tribe, the great Harvard law professor, had it also and wrote a piece in the Washington Post a few days after you and I talked. It's Nancy Pelosi doesn't send the articles of impeachment over to the Senate for some time. And my position was she should send it over to the Senate. Never, ever. Just it's over. It's a corrupt system. Mitch McConnell has said not only that he can't be impartial. He's not an impartial juror, he says, but also that he's going to work in lockstep with the White House. And I was upset back in the Clinton impeachment days when Tom Daschle, who was then the Democratic leader in the Senate, did occasionally talk to the White House staff about the process of the impeachment. That troubled me. But at least Daschle never said or even suggested he was going to work in lockstep with whatever the White House lawyers wanted. Now, what has happened is Nancy Pelosi and Chuck Schumer, for whom I don't have a great deal of love, but Schumer says, well, we're going to demand that there be 4 witnesses in the Senate at the trial. And Mitch McConnell so far, as we're talking the day after Christmas here, he says, no, we're not having any witnesses whatsoever. So what would happen is the Chief Justice of the Supreme Court, who is the judge. So that's not a completely accurate phrase, but it's the one everybody uses. The judge over the impeachment of Donald Trump in the Senate, he could rule on the admissibility or the existence of any specific witnesses.
Do we know that for certain? Have they ever decided how much the Chief Justice can do during an impeachment trial?
I think there's a general consensus that he says he makes the first rulings. In other words, if he decides, he looks over whatever the agreements have been made. They will make some agreements. How long is it going to take? He gets to make certain decisions. If he says, I think this process would be best served if the four witnesses that Chuck Schumer wants were, in fact, at least deposed, not necessarily in front of the whole Senate. They deposed people like Monica Lewinsky for hours on video prior to the trial of Bill Clinton, but she wasn't there. Nobody wanted her there. They thought that would, every side thought it would be cruel. It would look stupid. And it wouldn't benefit either party. But he makes the decision. But then let's say Mitch McConnell says, well, you know, Your Honor, and all, frankly, I disagree with that. And I would like to take a vote, as he has the right to do, take a vote on whether those witnesses would show up. And if they get 51 senators to overrule the Chief Justice, then I think his general view is that those witnesses would not show up. And now everybody's apoplectic. They're so excited about having a fair trial because Lisa Murkowski, who's actually, you know, kind of a reasonable person, a senator from Alaska, she said just about 24 hours ago that she was
disturbed.
Disturbed. And this follows in the footsteps of Susan Collins of Maine, desperately trying to save her own Senate seat, who was troubled by the idea of close collaboration, near identity between the Senate.
Almost as disturbed and troubled by the behavior of Brett Kavanaugh.
Yeah, they were both. Well, Lisa Murkowski, you know, actually wasn't there for the vote, but she did say if she had been there, she would have voted against him. Of course, Susan Collins made this big pitch. I'm going to speak at a certain hour, 3 o'clock on a Friday afternoon. I'm going to tell you what I decide. And then gives an unnecessarily affirmative view of how great a guy Brett Kavanaugh is. And she's never backed down on that. And the woman who's running against her, Sarah Gideon in Maine, has just amassed an enormous war chest to run against Susan Collins. And the polls I've seen lately show that Susan Collins is, in fact, in real trouble. But when you take those two people and, you know, our friend Mitt Romney, he's upset about some of this. And there are other people who might, you know, I saw some articles today and then this is, you know, I'm in New England. I'm not even in Washington. Ben Sasse, Cory Gardner, who's almost certainly going to lose his Senate seat in Colorado, that they might be maybes. So if you got three people to vote essentially with the Chief Justice and against the will of Mitch McConnell, you could reverse that negative decision. I mean, you could end up with these witnesses showing up or being. So everybody's getting excited about that. And this is why I'm not getting excited about it. It's great to talk about how you want a fair trial, but do we even know anything about what will be said by those four people, Mick Mulvaney, John Bolton, two other officials? You know, it's kind of law school first day of criminal justice. Whoever your professor is always says, never call a witness unless you know what she or he is going to say. But I think there's a bigger problem here, and that is, let's say somebody like John Bolton, why do we think he would tell the truth? Why wouldn't he just spin it?
He's got a $2 million book deal.
Yeah, why wouldn't he wait for the book?
Because, well, I mean.
Well, no, why wouldn't he wait for the book? Why would he? In fact, here's the other thing. And there's just nothing written about this. I was going to call our mutual friend, Corey Brett Schneider, but I didn't have my phone hooked up here, so I couldn't. But why? You don't lose your right against self-incrimination. You don't lose your Fifth Amendment rights just because you're a witness before a government body. You have to be careful what you say. You have to. It's not true that you can't answer any questions. That's kind of a fiction developed from television. There are questions you can answer, and then you can stop and say, no, I'm not going any further because that might incriminate me. So why wouldn't these lawyers, John Bolton's lawyer, why wouldn't he say, just don't say much of anything. Say a few things. If you want to confirm, it gets dangerous if you confirm what someone has said he overheard you saying, that gets you in trouble. Just don't say anything.
Right, right.
And then we get nothing out of it. So we get the appearance of a fair trial because there are witnesses who appear, but they don't say anything. And why would you?
Right.
Why would these thugs say anything? They shouldn't. Yep. I mean, if they want.
Yeah.
Okay, but let me, it's Richard Jewell.
Richard Jewell.
Okay, this is a horrible story. I'm glad Clint Eastwood told it. We were at the Olympics in 96, 3 days before this bombing occurred, and it was a horrendous event. I mean, there's a beautiful, the prospect of kind of world peace for a couple of weeks at the Olympics, of course, had been shattered by the killing of Israeli athletes some years before. But this was a wonderful event. And here's this guy, Richard Jewell, who is accused by the Atlanta Journal-Constitution of being the person who not only found the bomb, called it in so that people were able to be moved away from the blast site, but also, said the Atlanta Journal-Constitution, he was the bomber. He fit the profile of a lone white guy interested in being in law enforcement. He fit that profile, and they pilloried him. And newspapers all over the country focused almost exclusively on Richard Jewell as the bomber. Now, the criticism from this, from a lot of my friends on the left, is from two sources. One is they say it fits into Clint Eastwood's vision that the media is your enemy and the government is your enemy. Well, the FBI, that one way or another, did convey misinformation that led to Richard Jewell's vilification. That, you know, in the 60s and the 70s, people like us, we didn't like the FBI. They weren't the good guys. Now, because of Jim Comey and other people, well, the FBI has really cleaned up its act. Well, I'm very skeptical of that, and I don't care if people say, well, Clint Eastwood, I mean, he's just so far much a right-winger, he doesn't even like the FBI. And then the other criticism they have is that there is a composite FBI agent in the film. In other words, he does not exist in real life. There's also a reporter who does exist, and she died recently. She did exist in real life. And she is depicted in a bar, kind of cuddling up to this fictitious FBI agent, suggesting that she wanted some information, and then she'd go to bed with him.
Right.
And that's viewed as horrible. So I did a lot of research on this. I was kind of fascinated by this for a long time. And there's no evidence she ever slept with anyone for the sake of a story, but there's a lot of reporting of how provocatively she dressed, how she seemed to use her appearance, you know, conventionally attractive woman, to get information. So, no, maybe she never slept with anybody, but my God, if she was using those, what used to be called the feminine wiles, to get information, and they just ratcheted it up a notch, she still got the information from somebody, and she used this technique. And that's on the historical record. Go see the movie.
Okay.
And enjoy it.
All right.
And the hell with this criticism from my fellow leftists. I don't believe it. I don't believe it stains the fact that this was a guy whose life was literally ruined because, yes, there was big media, and yes, there was some leak from the FBI that ruined the man's life. And
that's Did they ever find out who did it?
Yes, Eric Rudolph.
That's right. That's right. He did other bombings as well, right?
What?
He did other bombings as well, right?
Yes, he did. And it took them years to find him. And of course, had they not focused so much attention at the beginning of the investigation on the crime on Richard Jewell, it's possible they would have found him earlier. But that's just speculation.
The Reverend Barry W. Lynn was the executive director of Americans United for Separation of Church and State from 1992 to November of 2017. He is an ordained minister in the United Church of, I hope I'm getting this right, Christ?
Yep, yep.
I pronounced that right? He is also a lawyer and author of many great books, including Piety and Politics.
Yep, that's it. Uh-huh. Yep, that's certainly it. And what's the other one? I like the other one better.
Let me look. What's the other one? I can't mispronounce that. What?
God and Government.
God and Government, yeah. Which you can buy all these at bookstores.
At Amazon, you can buy them. I still see them in bookstores every once in a while.
How do people follow you on Twitter?
I think you go to Real Rev Barry Lynn. I think I have some more slots still open, although I must say a lot of your listeners are filling these up on Facebook, whatever that limit is, 5,000 people or something. I always accept the friendship of Facebook people that are listeners of yours.
Well, let me ask you a question.
Yes.
Before you go.
Yes.
When did you get the cold?
I got this cold in earnest about 5 days ago.
Oh, okay. I got it about 3 days ago. And what kind of medicine are you using? Because you sound great. I mean, you're clear-headed and...
You see, to me, what was that?
Oh, hang on. Let me...
Go back.
Did you hear that?
No.
Okay. Well, we learned how to use the cough button today.
That's great. I don't think I have a cough button on this, but I'm sure you have a much more elaborate studio than my makeshift studio right here in Hanover, Massachusetts.
What medicines are you on? Because I'm about to use some.
I'm not taking any cold medicines. I don't think they're generally effective. I do think if you haven't gotten you're just getting the cold. If you said, I just started it 3 hours ago, I'd say take zinc tablets. Right. I do think that delays the onset. But once the thing's fully blown from the head of Zeus grown, there's not much you can do. I have such a sore throat at night. I have to take a chloroseptic or spray it in my throat.
Did you just say such a sore throat?
Yeah.
I thought you were a reverend, not a rabbi.
It's good, though. Hey, I got one more religious point to make.
Okay.
When I was in seminary, I went to school in Boston, and I was able to take courses anywhere, at Harvard, at Boston University, at Boston College. And at Boston College, I took a class in Zen Buddhism from a Jesuit priest. And the final exam was the following incident. This is what happened. You walked in. He said, this is your question for the final exam. I'm writing this on the blackboard. God is dog spelled backwards. He said, write about that. Well, people were scratching their heads. But I was sitting there going, I think I have a perfect answer. I just wrote, we had those things called blue books.
I remember blue books.
So I opened it to the first page. I wrote my name, and then I wrote the word yes. And I got an A.
Is that true?
Yes, it is true.
That's great. That's fantastic.
Yeah.
That's great.
Well, on that positive a note.
Well, happy New Year. We won't talk to you. Well, let's see, next week.
Yeah, we'll probably talk next week.
Yeah, let's do it next week.
Share some New Year's resolutions. Right. I'd love to do that because maybe if we talk late enough in the week, it'll be the second maybe of January, and then we can talk about the ones we've already broken.
Yes.
How's that?
Yes. Perfect. Thank you.
Thank you, Dave.
I'll talk to you next week. Stand in line for 1 second,
sure.
Reverend. Thank you.